that there was a very nice pen found in this room either earlier today or yesterday, and it's, and if you are the one that's lost it or, you know, somebody has, it's at the registration desk downstairs. I want to remind everybody the reception is at 6 and dinner is at 7. I know I make it a policy never to be late for dinner. It's in the tent. And for the speakers, I just want to remind them that static electricity that comes from the movement from the microphone tends to make a lot of crackling noises, so you might want to try to be as still as you can. And also, when you're using the overhead, you want to move your overhead as far to the top as possible so we can all see from the back, as far back as we can. And this room is probably small enough that we can ask questions without the microphone, as long as you speak up. So our first speaker today is Dr. Van de Loestrecht from Utrecht University, and he's going to speak on the influence of potassium on titania-supported nickel-iron catalysts for Fischer-Tropsch synthesis.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to tell you about the influence of potassium on nickel iron catalysts in the Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. This work has been done in the research group of Professor Geus at Utrecht University in the Netherlands. Normally, in Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, cobalt-based and iron-based catalysts are used to produce higher hydrocarbons. Supported nickel catalysts are normally used for methanation purposes. These nickel catalysts are very active and produce mainly methane. Supported iron catalysts produce higher hydrocarbons, however, they form bulk carbides and deactivate in time. Nickel iron alloy catalysts also produce higher hydrocarbons, and fortunately, they do not form bulk carbides. However, they also deactivate in time. When you want to use a nickel iron catalyst, it's very important to have well-defined nickel iron catalysts. However, it's very difficult to prepare these catalysts with commonly used methods as co-impregnation and co-precipitation. Problems with these methods are that nickel and iron are randomly distributed over the support surface and they do not form a well-defined alloy. Another problem with this catalyst is that nickel and iron can react with the support and form a metal support compound during preparation. Therefore, our first objective is to prepare well-defined nickel-iron catalyst. We have done that by homogeneous deposition precipitation of complex cyanides. The advantages of this preparation method are that you get catalysts with a constant nickel-iron ratio for all active particles, and that nickel as well as iron do not react with the support because they are incorporated in the cyanide complex. Catalyst preparation will take place in three steps. The first step is the homogeneous deposition precipitation of the complex cyanides onto the titania support. We've seen by transmission electron microscopy that after precipitation we have small particles on the titania support. X-ray diffraction and Nussbaum spectroscopy results shows that we have formed well-defined nickel-iron cyanide complexes. The second step of the catalyst preparation is the oxidation of the cyanide ligands to remove these cyanide ligands and to form the mixed oxide. During temperature program calcination, we have done evolved gas analysis. Initially, at low temperatures, the oxygen concentration is very high, and at about 525 Kelvin, the oxygen is consumed by the oxidation of the cyanide ligands. And at this moment, carbon dioxide and nitrogen are formed. At about 555 Kelvin, the calcination is completed and all cyanide ligands are removed. After this calcination, we formed a mixed oxide. The last step in the preparation of these nickel iron catalysts is the reduction with hydrogen to form a well-defined nickel iron alloy. We have performed thermomagnetic analysis after the reduction at 673 Kelvin. In this figure, the magnetization of the samples is plotted as a function of the temperature. On the bottom of this figure, you can see a nickel reference sample. The magnetization of this sample decreases slowly with higher temperatures and becomes almost zero at about 630 Kelvin, which is the Curie temperature of a pure nickel phase. At the top of this figure, you can see the magnetization of a pure iron reference sample. This magnetization remains very high with higher temperatures, which is due to the fact that the Curie temperature of iron is about 1000 Kelvin, which is beyond our experimental possibilities. In the middle of this figure, you can see the magnetization curve of our nickel-iron catalyst. This magnetization decreases very slowly and becomes almost zero at about 850 Kelvin. Due to this figure, we concluded that in our catalyst there is no pure nickel phase present, and there's also no pure iron phase present. And consequently, we have formed a well-defined nickel iron alloy phase with a Curie temperature of about 850 Kelvin, which is in agreement with the literature. So summarizing the preparation of our nickel iron catalyst, we have formed small particles on our titania support. After precipitation, we have formed a nickel iron cyanide complex, which can be calcined in air, and a mixed oxide is formed. And after reduction in hydrogen, we have formed a well-defined nickel iron alloy, and no pure nickel or a pure iron phase is present. The next step in our research is the addition of potassium as a promoter. From literature on pure metals, we know that potassium can increase the selectivity towards higher hydrocarbons. Potassium can change the carbon monoxide conversion, and potassium can prevent carbon deposition. Therefore, our second objective of this study was to study the influence of potassium on titanium-supported nickel-iron alloy phases. We studied the selectivity, activity, and the deactivation in time. These catalysts were prepared as follows. We prepared a large batch of a nickel-iron catalyst by the cyanide method. This catalyst was oxidized, and subsequently potassium was added by means of incipient wetness impregnation of potassium carbonate solutions. The potassium loading varies between 0 and 5.0 weight percent. After drying, the catalysts were calcined at 573 Kelvin. Transmission electron microscopy and X-ray diffraction results shows that potassium is well dispersed on our catalyst after incipient wetness impregnation. X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy results shows that potassium is present on both the titanium support and the nickel iron phase after calcination. Before we can perform Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, we have to reduce our catalyst. We have studied this by temperature programmed reduction. In this figure, you can see the TPR patterns of several catalysts. You can see that as a function of the potassium loading, the onset temperature of reduction and the peak maximum of the reduction step shifts a little bit towards higher temperatures. And in the catalyst with a very high potassium loading, a second reduction step appears at very high temperatures. The second reduction step can be due to the decomposition of potassium carbonate. Therefore, we've prepared a potassium on titanium sample, and we've done TPR with this sample. You can see that the high reduction step in our catalyst is due to the decomposition or the reduction of our potassium carbonate. In our potassium on titanium sample, a second reduction step is also present, and this second reduction step was also observed in our catalyst. After reduction, we have done CO adsorption measurements, and we've studied this with infrared spectroscopy. At the bottom of this figure, you can see the CO adsorption on a potassium-free catalyst. You can see a CO absorption band at about 2040 wave numbers, which is due to linearly bonded carbon monoxide. As a function of the potassium loading, the CO absorption bands shift to lower wave numbers, and this can be due to a weakening of the carbon-oxygen bonding due to the presence of potassium on the nickel-iron surface. The effects of potassium are that potassium weakens the carbon-oxygen bonding. This can increase the CO dissociation in Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. A second effect of potassium was that the reduction of our nickel-iron phase was retarded by potassium, and this is possibly due to a decreased hydrogen dissociation. So what is now the effect of potassium on the Fischer-Tropsch synthesis? We have done Fischer-Tropsch synthesis after reduction at 673 Kelvin. Fischer-Tropsch synthesis was performed at 525 Kelvin with a hydrogen to carbon monoxide ratio of 2 and a pressure of 1 bar. In this figure, the CO conversion is plotted as a function of time. There are several effects can be observed. Firstly, the initial CO conversion decreases very sharply as a function of the potassium loading. This is probably due to the presence of potassium on the nickel-iron phase, which lowers the active phase of the catalyst. The second effect which can be observed is the deactivation in time, which is probably due to the deposition of carbon. The relative deactivation in time is lower when potassium is present on our catalyst. The selectivities towards several products in Fischer-Tropsch synthesis is plotted as a function of the potassium loading. Most important is the selectivity towards higher hydrocarbons, which increases with small amounts of potassium and an optimum of the selectivity towards higher hydrocarbons can be observed at about 0.2-0.3 weight percent potassium. Even the yield towards higher hydrocarbons increases also with small amounts of potassium. It has also an optimum at about 0.2% potassium. So despite the decrease of the initial CO conversion due to the presence of potassium, we can see an increase of the yield towards higher hydrocarbons. So potassium causes several effects in Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. We've seen an increased selectivity towards higher hydrocarbons, with an optimum at about 0.2 weight percent potassium. This increase of the selectivity towards higher hydrocarbons is probably due to a change in the CO adsorption and dissociation properties, as well as in the change of the hydrogen dissociation properties. We've also seen that potassium causes a decrease of the CO conversion. This is probably due to a side-locking effect by potassium of the nickel iron surface. Concludingly, the preparation of well-defined nickel iron catalysts by using complex cyanides is successful. Potassium causes several effects with an optimum at about 0.2% potassium. And at this optimum, we have seen that potassium causes a higher selectivity and a higher yield towards higher hydrocarbons. Potassium causes less deactivation in time. However, the CO conversion decreases. Finally, I want to acknowledge NWO and SOM for financial support. And I want to thank you.
Questions?
Yes.
This is a comment and interpretation, perhaps, for your deactivation curves. One of the statements you made was that the potassium decreased the rate of deactivation or some sort of statement like that. Actually, I would turn the statement around and say the potassium pre-deactivated your catalyst. One of the things that we've shown with ruthenium, at least, using isotopic tracing methods, is that when you put potassium often on metals, what you you can select, the distribution of the potassium is not homogeneous on the surface. And in the case of ruthenium, at least, you seem to knock out the most active sites first, and those are the ones that give you the steep deactivation curve, and then you start leveling off when you've got sort of moderately active sites, but they're not deactivating very rapidly.
This could also be an explanation of this effect.
Cal Bartholomew, BYU. I thought it was interesting the kind of behavior you observed in terms of methane make and also hydrocarbon production as a function of the potassium added in cobalt and in iron systems. As you add more potassium, you tend to get a slight decrease and not a large decrease in conversion. And you continually get less methane make, and you continually get heavier products, but you seem to go through a maximum. And I wondered if you could explain what is happening at the point where you go through this minimum in methane make and the maximum in C3 production, and then you start up again in methane and go down. What's happening in your catalyst at that point?
Yes, that's a good question. It's very difficult to explain that effect. We thought that maybe could be due to the presence of potassium on the surface, which causes less mobility of CH2 fragments, so they couldn't reach each other. And because of hydrogen is more mobile than these CH2 fragments, maybe that's the reason why methane is formed and no higher hydrocarbons.
Let me ask a couple other questions that are really important to explaining this. What was the overall surface area of your catalyst? What was the metal surface area? What was the coverage of of potassium on the surface? And what was the composition of your surface? Is it mostly nickel or iron? And I think these are questions you need to address if you're going to answer this question, particularly were you saturated in potassium already at 0.1%
mm-hmm.
or 0.2%? Do you know?
After reduction, the surface of our active phase is a nickel iron alloy. You've seen that with XPS measurements.
And does it have the same composition as the bulk?
It has the same composition.
Okay.
But what happens during Fischer-Tropsch synthesis is less clear.
Do you know what percentage of potassium you would saturate the surface?
No, I don't know.
I have a question about the titanium support, because you're doing your reductions at fairly high temperature during your preparation of the catalyst. And my concern would be is whether any titanium species are getting on that surface, and they may be playing a role in your reaction.
I don't think so, because we've also prepared pure nickel catalysts on titanium. And we have done reduction experiments at several different reduction temperatures. And after reduction at 400 degrees Celsius, we haven't seen any effect of titanium on the nickel surface. While when we reduce our catalysts at 500 degrees Celsius, we see a large effect of the titanium support.
I heard that you mentioned all the particles are nickel iron alloys. And this is actually two questions related. I wonder, goes back to your nickel iron cyanide complex. Is that possible that you put a very simple formula, but instead it's an extended three-dimensional structure by a cyanide linkage? Whether this going to, this makes sense if it forms nickel iron cyanide, but whether it could hurt you as long as the particle size is concerned, whether you can control it actually by control the polymerization process.
I don't understand your question. What do you mean?
You said you form nickel iron alloys.
Yes.
And I want to know how big are these alloys?
How big they are?
Yes. Are they fairly big?
5 to 10 nanometers.
Can you repeat the question?
My concern is the nickel iron cyanide complex is instead a three-dimensional complex.
Why don't you come up to the microphone?
My concern is the nickel iron cyanide complex is instead an extended three-dimensional polymeric structure. While you're decomposing it, it might form a large particle sizes. In the same time, all the particles contain nickel NR.
No, we just form small particles. We form particles between 5 and 10 nanometers. So the particles are smaller.
Is that how small they are after calcination? I mean, you mentioned that before, right after you first formed them. But do you know how big they are after you've calcined them?
No, we measured that.
Any other questions?
I want to address the temperature program reduction. We normally try to vary this quantitatively. Have you done this in the same way? Can you, you know how many moles you have used as for the hydrogen and so on? And
yes.
And how, to what a degree of a reduction then this corresponds? Are your finally your catalysts totally reduced?
The degree of reduction of our iron alloy phases are about 100%.
Finally, 100% reduced.
Let me say, I'm getting motions from the back of the room from people saying they can't hear. So I think we're going to have to line up at the microphone or talk louder to so that everybody can participate in the discussion.
Yes. But nevertheless, it may turn out that the maximum degree of reduction, yeah, the maximum degree of reduction must not then produce the best catalysts. It often happens that there's an optimum degree of reduction for synthesis, for the best activity of the catalyst.
Yes,
so
but the degree of reduction of all catalysts is about 100%.
You can hear me in the back, right?
Speak louder.
First, a comment. Nickel is an extremely dangerous thing to have in a fission probe's catalyst, and I hope that if we do put it there one day, it's for a very good reason. So my question is, what is the good reason to have nickel in this catalyst as far as activity and selectivity compared to the iron catalyst that we already own? And if the answer is there's no reason to do that, then what is the mechanistic reason? In other words, what does it teach us about Fischer-Tropsch that we could benefit from the associated danger?
Well, And the reason for alloying iron with nickel was that iron catalysts form iron carbides. And in certain cases, you don't want these iron carbides. And due to the alloying of iron with nickel, we can prevent this carbidization effect. So that was the main reason for alloying iron with nickel.
So what does it tell us about the requirement for carbide or the deleterious effects of carbide?
What do you mean?
What does it teach us about, you have avoided the carbide.
Yes.
So what has that taught us about the need for a carbide or the deleterious effects of a carbide?
These nickel iron catalysts are more active than the iron catalysts. So by preventing the carbide formation, we can improve the activity of these catalysts.
But not over conventional iron catalysts, which are carbided. Have you compared your activities with the Sasol co-precipitated iron catalyst?
No, we can't get that.
Are there any other questions? Well, let's thank our speaker again. We actually have about 2 minutes before the next talk will start, so don't go away. But we'll start.